I'm always looking to improve upon what I've done.
Stand still.
Better taking care of the animals, giving them a better life, growing bigger antlers, and seeing them succeed gives me a feeling of succeeding myself. I'm a farmer. I happen to be a white-tailed deer farmer.
This is Doug Roberts. He's raised some of the largest typical whitetails in North America. His farm produces the best hunting scents in the world. His life's quest is 200-inch typical whitetails. This is ConQuest 200.
Can we pray right now so I can get out with the workers?
Sure. Dear Lord, we thank you for another day, and we ask that you help us to be a blessing unto others, and may you be with us as we go through the work that we do today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Gotta go.
On ConQuest Deer Farm, the process of collecting semen is an annual occurrence. Once a year, the breeder bucks are darted and are transported to the facility. A team from Advanced Deer Genetics extracts the semen and freezes it in liquid nitrogen. On the day of use, it's then warmed to the exact body temperature of the doe. This activates the sperm cells so that the artificial insemination process can begin.
Through this AI process, we are trying to get the genetic combinations to grow the biggest typical whitetails in North America. Yep. What the AI technician is doing right now is she is actually putting the straw of semen down in through the vaginal tract by the cervix and injecting the sperm cells into the cervical area so we can get a natural conception. Once we inject the semen into the doe, she's then put back into her pen for 10 to 12 days without any buck. And then we put a backup buck, a buck. If they don't catch to the artificial insemination, they will cycle back in naturally, and then that buck will actually breed her naturally. So all of the does on the farm will still have fawns through AI or through natural breeding.
One thing is certain, the arrival of fawns is inevitable. This time of year is exciting for all the staff. The birth of over 150 fawns will take place on the deer farm. Many of these fawns are genetic combinations that Doug has specifically planned. The rest are conceived by Doug's breeder bucks. One of these breeders is a 1.5-year-old named Triton.
About 165, 170-inch 1.5-year-old buck that we're gonna use as a backup buck. Just a beautiful, beautiful buck for a 1.5-year-old. So we're gonna use him as a backup buck. We did collect semen off him. We got 155 straws of just top quality grade A semen. So we're gonna use him as a backup this year, see what he turns out to be as a 2-year-old, but we've got semen now that we can breed him for the next 5, 10, 15 years if we choose to, but I got high hopes for this buck. This is just an awesome, awesome looking deer.
From the time we collect semen and we artificially inseminate that doe and she's sent back out to her pen, we know life has begun. It's really amazing if you think about it. And then we get to anticipate that pregnancy with her until birth happens in the spring. We're all like expectant parents here, waiting for that birth to happen and see life start again.
Coming up next, the search begins for the first fawns. It's April on ConQuest Deer Farm in Davison, Michigan. As always, perimeter checks are first responsibility. The staff is constantly checking the perimeters to see if any issues on the farm need immediate attention.
I'll get you dirty.
I'm already dirty. Do you really think that's going to work? That's it.
Goes out.
I've set up two ways that we actually are able to really monitor and look at the deer on a daily basis and sometimes a couple times a day on the farm. And one of those is by going around and doing the perimeter check. We're checking the perimeter fence to make sure that everything is safe and secure, but at the same time, we're looking into all of the pens and watching what the deer are doing and checking on all of them to make sure that they're fine.
Just kind of check everything out, make sure it's like zombie proof basically.
But at the same time, we're looking into all of the pens, filling the water tanks and checking on the feeders to make sure they have plenty of food. We're again, from internally in the farm, looking at all of the deer and making sure that everybody is safe and sound.
Every day, every single day. It's just like waking up, brushing your teeth. It's like ritual. They count on us and we obviously count on them, but we have to take care of them best as possible. They get thirsty.
When spring comes, you're always getting excited and you anticipate the birth of the newborn fawns, but you're always concerned too with the weather and the temperature because we don't want any of those problems. So you're kind of nervous at this time as spring is coming, but yet you're kind of excited because you start to see the moms getting bigger. You can start to see the fawns moving inside their bellies.
With a projected arrival of over 150 fawns, Doug knows that these fawns could produce the next world-class typical whitetail. It's been a six-month wait, and the does that have been artificially inseminated are ready to give birth.
We've had the privilege of watching a few different times does give birth, and the instinct that kicks in to be a good caring mother. Those does, there's no mom telling them, there's no nurse telling them, there's nobody there helping them. It's just such great appreciation for nature to see that they know exactly what to do and to watch them clean off their baby and love them and care for them.
Whitetail deer very seldom have complications with giving birth. Sometimes new moms, yearling moms, will forget they have a fawn or they will just lose track where that fawn is at. So we kind of gently try to make sure that everybody's keeping track of the fawns they have and where they're at, and also making sure that they just don't get caught into brush piles or little predicaments that they could get injured or even worse yet, maybe die.
Coming up next.
This is an extremely uncommon, rare situation where you have two fawns side by side. Out in nature, the does do not put fawns side by side. My guess would be they're not even brother and sister. See, this one's breathing harder, but this one actually is holding its breath right here, just acting like it's not even here. A couple unique things about newborns. You can see how blue the eyes are, and they're blue for a couple weeks, two and a half weeks until they get old enough where they can run and they can evade predators for the most part and stuff like that. But they're always in this tucked into position. One, it keeps the body warmth in there, and two, they stay protected.
One of them just wasn't very happy with it right now. The only smell that a fawn will emit is either urinating or defecating. Mom stimulates them to go to the bathroom, and she actually eats all of that product to keep the smell off the ground from where that fawn is at. So she will clean them up very well, and I know that sounds gross, but what it does, it allows this fawn for the first few weeks of life to have absolutely no smell, and that's what keeps so many of them alive. If you find a fawn in the wild and it is bedded down like this, even if it's in your yard or next to a road, it's being taken care of. This fawn is perfectly fine. It will stay in this position until mom comes back to find it again to nurse it the next time. And it could be hours. So if you find one in the morning and it's there later afternoon, that's okay. Mom is somewhere within earshot or sight distance and knows exactly where that fawn is at.
Heather and I are going to go out right now, and we're going to go into one of the breed pens where some of the fawns have been born. And what I like to do is I give them a little vaccination and especially a little vitamin booster. It allows them to get a little bit of energy into that system and just gives them a little boost where they're stronger and healthier for the next couple weeks.
You're going to put 1 cc of the vitamin B complex, and then the other syringe, a 0.5 cc of Bosin.
It's easier to do the first couple days right after they're born, because about the third or fourth day they get up and they're running, and there's just no possible way you're actually going to catch them.
The booster shot helps aid the fawns with vitamins. Being in the pens also allows Doug to check on the sex of the fawns and see what kind of buck to doe ratio he has. But it's not long until mothers are on high alert.
Well, it's kind of amazing when you walk into a fawning pen, because the does immediately go on high alert. Nature has built them to survive and only intercede when she knows for sure something is gonna go wrong.
Stand still.
With the does agitated and in distress, Doug decides to head out and come back when things are settled down. Little does he know, there's big news that awaits him in the scent facility.
Can you come here?
Yeah.
We got something here. I think you're gonna wanna look at it. The prototypes for the Stink Stick scent dispenser came in. We're so excited about this new product. So this is the one that's gonna have tubes in it?
I'm really excited to get out to Wyoming this fall and actually do a bow hunt and take our new scent dispenser, the Stink Stick, out there and give it a try with a new product.
We're out here in Wyoming. It's the third day, and we've seen a lot of deer, but we just have not gotten anything close enough that's mature that we can shoot. It's been an awesome time, but the temperature has also kind of skyrocketed up. And we got the Stink Sticks out here in front of us. What we did is we took branches, the leaves that they like to eat, and marked it at 30 yards and at 40 yards, and actually hung a Stink Stick on each one with Evercomb in it. And feel pretty good about this set right now tonight.
Adam Hayes, my cameraman, and I, we actually had driven past this barn and realized that the deer had really been hanging around that. So we actually went out behind and actually snuck up into the top loft of this old barn that had been there forever.
Whitetail in 17 years with a bow. Get things going, I gotta be on an airplane first thing in the morning.
After a successful hunt with the prototype Stink Stick, it's on a flight back to Michigan for a full day of whitetail farming.
Really? You brought
three pairs of pants. Yeah.
The first major project is tagging fawns.
First thing that we're going to do today is start bringing the breed pens up one at a time to start sorting the fawns from their moms and giving them all their vaccinations and tagging them.
We brought four.
Yeah.
To grab a fawn in a 4x10 space, well, it's tough. You got to be able to get them into a corner, and there's a way of doing it. And it's a certain way you pick them up so that you don't get cut, because their hooves are razor sharp. And that's why you go through so many pants, because they are razor sharp and they're kicking.
Well, as things normally go on the farm, you know, we're bringing the deer up from the pen, and of course you get into the runway and you always have one fawn or one deer that decides it doesn't want to go, turns around, and here it comes right back at me.
Keep coming.
These fawns have never been out of their pen and into the runway or up to the handling facility, so this is a new experience for the fawns, and they're simply just following and going along with their moms.
With all the deer into the facility, the team now prepares to vaccinate and tag each fawn. Each fawn will receive two tags. One is a farm tag, and the other is a metal tag issued by the United States Department of Agriculture.
State and federal law requires us that we need two types of identification in each animal on our farm. One is a dangle tag that identifies just with a color. It's a farm tag. The other tag needs to be an electronic tag or a metal tag that's brought from USDA. And that has to stay with that animal its entire life.
Ready?
The sounds some of these fawns make are curling. It's kind of like when a kid gets their booster shot. Same with fawns. You're giving them their antibiotics. You're, you know, looking over them, making sure they're healthy, but you know they don't want it. But you can't tell them, you know, this is good for you. They don't want to hear it.
I was warned the first day that we did this to bring extra pants, and it was very evident really quickly why you need to have more than one pair of pants on that day.
It's extremely difficult to catch a little fawn in a little area in that runway, 4x8.
I'm looking at your side. You okay?
Yeah. I think he got me.
Yeah, he got you good. Need a break?
Well, that was a nice little warm-up.
Well, now that the fawns are actually and officially a part of the farm and they're recorded with the ear tags, the process they're going to go through is they're going to grow up through the next year. The doe fawns will actually get bred. Once we bring the doe fawns, or the yearling does, into the breeding program, we take the oldest group of does out of the breeding program and they go into our scent collection process. And so they become scent collectors. They stay on the farm, they have a great life, they just don't have fawns anymore. And we collect our scent, the bucks too. There's a certain select group that we'll keep back for collecting our scent products, and the rest of them will get sold off to other hunting ranches and other breeding farms.
From the point of artificial insemination to the birth, to the weaning and tagging them and finding out the sex of that fawn and giving it its serial number that we are by law required to do, they have now become a resident of this family and of this farm. This fawn is what provides our income, which provides our future.
Good. War rule number two.
Stay tuned for scenes of next week's episode.
tired of the pains. I'm tired of not being able to do what I need to do.
Has anything ever escaped in the last 3 years?
No.
Hey, what's up?
Hey, Doug, we've got a problem. There's a doe in pen 10 that's having a seizure.
For more info and behind-the-scene action, visit ConQuest200.com.